It's called the Ten Commandments of the Antichrist by some and America's Stonehenge by others. Some say that it's evil and satanic, while others say that it's the holiest spot on earth and that the Holy Grail is buried underneath it. What I'm referring to is the very controversial Georgia Guidestones in Elberton, Georgia in Elbert County. Elberton is in the northeast of the state and it's near the South Carolina border, and it's also the granite capital of the world. The stones were built to survive the apocalypse, so on the Guidestones are recommendations to the civilization that survives a cataclysmic event that wipes out most of humanity. It has one very, very controversial recommendation that has caused some very interesting conspiracy theories, and I'll talk about that in just a little bit. There's also a security camera that monitors the location because of past vandalism. And a lot of people really do not like this monument, but don't worry, I'll tell you why shortly. The story began on a Friday afternoon in June of 1979 when a tall, attractive, gray-haired man traveled to Elbert County and visited the offices of Elberton Granite Finishing. He introduced himself as Robert C. Christian, and he told Joe Finley, the company president, that wasn't his real name. He said he used that name for anonymity and because he was a follower of Jesus Christ. He said that he represented a group of people that wanted to remain anonymous and that had been secretly planning the Guidestones for about 20 years, and that he'd come to Elberton because of the climate and because they had the best granite on earth. Once R.C. Christian started explaining what he wanted on the stones, Joe Finley thought that he was a bit off, so he tried to discourage the man by giving him a quote that was several times higher than the actual cost. But that didn't faze Christian, so he also told Finley that the monument had to be able to survive the apocalypse. He told Finley that our civilization was going to destroy itself, and the monument would provide instructions for those that were left after an earth-changing cataclysmic event. The Guidestones weren't meant to be just a bunch of instructions for the future of mankind. It also had to function as a clock, a calendar, and a compass. So Joe Finley sent Christian to Wyatt Martin, who was the president of the Granite City Bank at the time. Now, Wyatt Martin told Christian that he couldn't proceed until he could verify his identity and that R.C. Christian could prove that he could actually pay for this very strange project. So they made an agreement that R.C. Christian would reveal his real name, only if Wyatt Martin promised to service his sole intermediary. He had to sign a confidentiality agreement. He also had to agree to destroy all documents and any records that were related to the project once it was completed. So Wyatt Martin and Joe Finley were very skeptical, but a $10,000 deposit did arrive and work started shortly after that. So Christian sent money from different banks across the country so that it couldn't be traced. And Christian met with Finley and gave him a shoebox that contained a wooden model of the monument that he wanted, as well as several pages of detailed specifications. Once they agreed on a location for the monument, Wayne Mullenix, the landowner, signed over a 5-acre plot for $5,000. Once things were underway, Christian stopped by Joe Finley's office to say goodbye and that you'll never see me again. So from then on, Christian only wrote letters to Wyatt Martin to ask that ownership of the land be transferred to the county. So the letters would come from cities all over the country, and they never came from the same place twice. The project took 9 months to complete, and workers had to trim 4 tons from each stone so that they would fit the exact specifications. The total amount of the project wasn't revealed, but banker Wyatt Martin said that it was well over $100,000. On March 22, 1980, the Georgia Guidestones were unveiled on the vernal equinox, which is the March or spring equinox in the Northern Hemisphere. The stones are each 16 feet tall, with 4 of them weighing more than 20 tons. They support a 25,000 pound capstone, and a 100-foot crane was used to lift the stones into place. The messages on the stones are written in 8 languages: English, Spanish, Swahili, Hindi, Hebrew, Arabic, Chinese, and Russian. The United Nations provided some of the translations. The capstone says, "Let these be Guidestones to an age of reason." And that is written in classical Greek, Sanskrit, Egyptian hieroglyphs, and Babylonian cuneiform. An additional stone tablet that's set in the ground a short distance to the west of the actual monument provides some information on the history and the purpose of the Guidestones. The astrological features on the stone were so complex that the builder, Joe Finley, had to work with an astronomer from the University of Georgia. The monument sits at the highest point in Elbert County, and the east and west corners of the monument track the sunrise and the sunset. On this graphic, you'll see where number 2 shows what looks like a mail slot, and if you stand at the west side of the slot during an equinox or solstice, you can see the sunrise on the horizon. Number 3 shows a hole at eye level, where if you stand on the south side of the monument, you can see the North Star. Number 4 shows a hole that was drilled through the capstone that shines a sunbeam on the center column, and at noon pinpoints the day of the year. So it's kind of like a giant granite Swiss Army knife. Another astronomer from the University of Georgia was not impressed. He said that the features were very ordinary and that you could do something similar in your backyard with concrete. So what is on these stones and why is it so controversial? I'll show you. These are the 10 so-called commandments that are on the Georgia Guidestones. We'll start with number 10 and work our way up to the most controversial. Number 10, be not a cancer on the earth. Number 9, prize truth, beauty, love, seeking harmony with the infinite. Number 8, balance personal rights with social duties. Number 7, avoid petty laws and useless officials. Sounds okay so far, right? Number 6, let all nations rule eternally, resolving external disputes in a world court. Okay, that doesn't sound too good. Number 5, protect people and nations with fair laws and just courts. Number 4, rule passion, faith, tradition, and all things with tempered reason. Number 3, unite humanity with a living new language. Number 2, guide reproduction wisely, improving fitness and diversity. Number 1, maintain humanity under 500 million in perpetual balance with nature. So, number 1 is obviously the most controversial, followed by number 3 and then number 6. A lot of people see number 2 as eugenics, and some think that number 1 is about planned genocide and that the monument calls for a drastic reduction in the population. The population was 3.4 billion in 1981 when the Guidestones went up. It's currently around 7.5 billion, and it'll probably be over 10 billion by 2050. So the stones call for maintaining humanity under 500 million. So how do you go about maintaining a future population of 500 million? How do you keep that number from rising? The population hasn't even been 500 million since the 1600s. So when it comes to number 1, you have two different sides. You have one side that thinks that the organization that's responsible for this monument want to get rid of the people that are already here and limit that to 500 million. On the other side of the coin, you have people that think that they're only talking about maintaining the population after a cataclysmic event. So let's say we have an extremely cataclysmic event and it wipes out 5 billion people. What if the cataclysmic event doesn't wipe out enough people? What are they going to do then? How are they going to get to their 500 million then? Just a thought. A lot of people think that the wealthy elite are responsible for this monument. And around 2009, it was reported that Ted Turner and what's called the Good Club had meetings on how to slow the growth of the world's population. And Ted Turner has even advocated for a 95% reduction of the population. And they say that they want to save the world. In a 2010 TED Talk, Bill Gates says the world today has 6.8 billion people. That's headed up to about 9 billion. Now, if we do a really great job on new vaccines, healthcare, reproductive health services, we lower that by perhaps 10 or 15%. Wyatt Martin said that when they started building the monument, that people told him to stop, and they accused him of being part of an occult movement. The sandblaster, Charlie Clamp, he carved each of the 4,000 plus characters on the stones. And he said that he was constantly distracted by strange music and disjointed voices. It's said that the Cherokee once believed that the center of the world was a few miles from the location of the monument. A local minister said that occult groups would flock to the Guidestones, and he warned that someday a sacrifice would take place there. Within a few months of its completion, a coven of witches from Atlanta called the Guidestones their home away from home and stopped by on the weekends for pagan rites. In 2009, a 6x6x6 cube was removed from the top corner of one of the stones. 4 years later, police arrested the person that stole it when he tried to return it. And he said that he stole it for personal esoteric and numerological reasons. The monument is off Georgia 77, and it's about 7 miles north of Elberton. So why did R.C. Christian and his group choose Elberton, Georgia? He chose the location because of the temperate climate and because there were 30 quarries there at the time. And supposedly R.C. Christian's great-grandmother was also from Georgia. Wyatt Martin dumped all correspondence associated with the Guidestones into a metal barrel and he burned them. He then poured the ashes into the lake. R.C. Christian kept in touch with Wyatt Martin regularly via mail, and they also met for dinner on several occasions. R.C. Christian also granted lifetime cattle grazing rights to the former landowner and his family. His construction company also got to lay the foundation for the stones. The Guidestones were also a popular spot during the total eclipse in 2017. Lastly, if you plan to visit the Guidestones, there's free parking and self-guided tours. The admission is free, and the monument is open all day, year round.